Going to say hi to you all. So welcome everyone to the Tuesday night talk. My name is Elizabeth Padilla and I will be your speaker tonight. And the topic is moving on and letting go, or should it be letting go and then move on? So we'll talk about that today. And I love this topic. I love thinking about it. On one hand, we're wanting to let go of something that is probably making us experience some pain, uneasiness, frustration, unresolved, unvalidated. And the more we try to let it go, do you feel that it sort of keeps lingering on? And what does it take to let go so that we can move on? And I'm also thinking about what it means to move on. Yes, to move into the future, but it made me realize in relationship to time that what I'm embracing really by letting go is embracing this moment. To move on means to accept and be present in this moment, which is a really lovely feeling. So, how to let go? What are the steps? So, let's take a look. Now I will share a PowerPoint. And it still doesn't want me to expand. Let's see. All right. So I'm imagining you can see this screen. Is that right?
Yes.
And can you see me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Okay. Except now you're gonna see all these little things. This isn't gonna work though.
I think the way you had it at first might have been better when.
Okay, so Jayesh, why don't you go ahead and share?
Yeah, that's okay. How you.
Okay, and you can see me and the screen, the PowerPoint.
Uh-huh.
Oh, isn't that nice? Okay. Actually, I love it when these trip ups happen because you can use them. You know, things happen. And how to just sort of let go and then move on to the next slide. But first, let's discuss this one. Why, what, hacks, and trip ups. What do you really want? If you're wanting to let go of something, and maybe it's painful, or maybe it's tiresome, maybe it's draining your energy. So then instead of focusing on what it is I want to remove, this question asks, what do I want? What do I really want? Or even what I need? And to identify that. We'll have a chance to ask some questions for ourselves. We'll have a little inquiry process. And then what to let go of, how to identify that in a way that really gets to the heart of the matter. Sometimes things happen and you think you're, if only this person wasn't in my life, this wouldn't happen. Or if only I had a new job and let go of that job, then I could move on with my life. And have you ever had that experience where you have your new job, you have your new relationship, you have your new car or your new something, and you're going, here it is again. Here we go again. Have you had that experience? Yes, no?
Definitely.
Yeah. So thank you. And so to really rediscover or uncover what really ails us and some tools for letting go, and also methods of, you know, because we can understand these concepts and I enjoy sharing them, but the next step is having power to follow through. You know, it sounds good, it feels good, but how can I make it a reality? So I need some tools and also some practices that will help me be more empowered, to give me strength, to give me faith, actually, in myself, faith in humanity. Sometimes that can pull your plug, right? Faith in a divine source or a divine reference for yourself. And this trip ups, I sort of revealed it already. We can go for the Band-Aid, we can go for that instant relief, and it can carry us to, so far, to a certain extent. But what does it mean to really let go? Wouldn't that be lovely? So next slide. So I did talk about the cherishing the present moment. And I love this metaphor of the lake. And just remember a time when you were visiting a lake in the early morning, and maybe you even live near a lake, and we're blessed here that up in the Sierras we have these freshwater lakes. And you can see right to the bottom. They're so clear. And I love this as a metaphor of the human being, the psyche, the soul, where we have an ability to look within and even see what's at the bottom of the lake. And that would be our subconscious. And everything that's ever happened to us is there. And just to value that we have a wealth of experience, it doesn't mean we have to, you know, do psychoanalysis or go, you know, and stir up things at the bottom of the lake. But that we have the ability, not only those memories, but also there are treasures. These experiences have given me gems. They've given me jewels in the form of qualities, abilities, virtues, and skills and powers. And I'm talking about spiritual strength, stamina, courage, perseverance, gentleness, love. And these are innate qualities that are already a part of us. And so when we meditate, what happens is the mind becomes calm and clear, just like this morning lake. And some of you may have heard me talk about this, where you can just look at the surface of the lake and see the world around you, right? The reflection of the world around you. And you can even look into the lake and see a reflection of yourself. So this is the ability of consciousness. The surface of the lake is consciousness, the bottom of the lake is the subconscious, and then the observer. What is the who? What is the observer? And that's my conscience, or the aspect in me that has the willpower, reasoning, intuition. So I have the ability of choice. As the observer, I can be more able to exercise that choice, to make a choice. So that's one tool, very important, to have that ability to stand back, reflect, and be the observer of my thoughts, of the scenes that are in front of me unfolding, and also looking at my past and perhaps anticipating future. But what's really cool is that it's happening from this present moment. Does the past exist? Next slide, please. Here's another metaphor that I would like to share with you, and this is a fountain. And this just helps us to expand our perspective a little bit on time. And for the sake of being able to tell time and manage time and keep up with time and keep in time, we have this measurement of past, present, and future. And I like to look at it as a fountain. And these traditional fountains, where it's just one spout coming out of the present moment, it will direct the water in all directions. And the past in that, there's the past, and then there's also the future. So imagine this midline where the water is emanating, meaning that energy flow. The only moment that is existing is this present moment. The only moment that I can engage in making a choice is the present moment. The only moment where I can make a difference, where I can engage in change, is this present moment. Can I change the past? Can I know the future? And so I am creating past and future from this present moment. And now I know that the only aspect of time that I can engage, change, inspire, motivate, turn around is this present moment. And when I make choices, they will affect not only the past, because those are the seeds we sow, right? And what goes around comes around, and what I put out comes back. So I'm also creating my future. So this is just to give strength and importance and value to the present moment. And so part of moving on is to understand how important it is to be in this moment. Okay, so now we understand that, we value that. So why not stay in the moment then, if it's so effective? Why can't we maintain this present moment? It's mindful, it's meditative, it's metaphysical, it's very effective. But how can I stay in the present? Why is it that I you know, it's known that 95% of our thoughts are of the past, which makes sense because it's we're dwelling on past experiences, but then we miss out on this present moment. And even if it's just 80% that our thoughts are dwelling on the past, and we project those, the past scenes, on how we actually experience this moment. I mean, if you had a room full of people and a child walks into the room, everybody would have a different reaction. And if the child started to cry, again, some would go right away to the need of that child, and some would go, ah, get me out of here, right? And so the past will immediately, you know, dictate how I behave in that present moment. And if you had seven people in that room, all seven would have a different reaction. And that's based on these past experiences. You know, and some people are experienced with children, and some people they are not. Some people adore children and they can really understand their world, you know. And so, of course, whatever I do in that moment, aiding the child, whatever is there present for me, I will get the return, or the future will open up accordingly by what I'm doing now. But it's interesting, it goes into the past, but then it's affecting my future. So that's why I like looking at it as this fountain, so that wherever I go, just knowing that I am creating both in this moment. And so this is the moment where awareness is really critical. So next slide, please. Okay, so this looks a little busy. Usually it, will come out in increments, so it's not so difficult. But anyway, I had talked about the lake, and so the mind is that surface of the lake, okay? And then actions, this is a little different. Now, this is where the rubber meets the road. So the mind and the sanskaras is the subtle aspect of the psyche, okay? And where we show up in the world is when our thoughts and feelings manifest in our actions. And 90% of our thoughts, at least this is what the professionals are saying, are dwelling on this resource of past, you know, memories, and projected on the screen of life. And I'm going to perform my actions in that way, right? Whatever my thoughts and attitudes and perspectives, isn't that how I'm going to perform even the simplest action? Like picking up this pen. I could pick it up with wonder, like I've never seen such a pen. Or I could look at it like, what a junky pen, who gave me this pen? I mean, your attitude will color how you use the pen. And the same with our relationships. Our attitudes will color how we respond, react, and relate to others. And then that action will leave an impression and that memory. And that memory comes around and will feed our thoughts. And the observer is the intellect. And where it needs to intervene is when, in all three sectors, where the mind, the thoughts and feelings come into action, you need to be awake and aware. Where the actions are stored in these memories, the intellect needs to be awake and aware. And where these memories surface, I need to be awake and aware. So let me give you an example. Okay. I did illustrate a little bit when these thoughts and feelings come, it's good to go, oh, wow, I'm really getting upset right now. I better not say anything. Right? And we'll stop. Have you stopped yourself? Have you been successful in stopping yourself from saying something? Like, oop, this isn't a good moment. I better not say anything, right? Because it's my buttons are getting pushed and I recognize that. And so then my actions will be more cautious. And then it will, and then of course, if, gosh, I don't want to create a dramatic scene here, but okay, let's say, oh, wow, that was a good idea. I didn't say what was going on in my mind. And yet that person left the room, right? Let's say that I had somebody comes into the room. I had these thoughts and feelings. I was ready to say something not nice. And I stopped myself. That's the intellect being aware before action. Then let's say the person leaves the room without saying anything. And then let's say, and then I have, this is where my reasoning needs to help facilitate how I store that event in my psyche, because that's going to stay there forever. And this is where mindful practice, spiritual practice really comes through. And to give benefit of the doubt of that person, everybody has a world, right, going on in their head and whatever their choices are, and to not take it personally. Imagine if you never took anything personally, how different your life would be. That I'm aware and I understand that everyone is responsible for their own emotions and feelings. And I am also responsible for mine. And that I can make a choice to leave a positive or a learning, because it's not all, some things are traumatic events that happen, right? And I notice that when I store something in the learning place in my memory bank, I make a learning deposit in my memory bank, I don't fester. I don't keep ruminating about it. It's gone. And that's the trick in letting go. When I take each moment as an opportunity of learning. Because I know that everything that happens, it comes to say goodbye. If I understand karma even a little bit, I understand that good, bad, indifferent, everything comes and goes. Happiness, does it last forever? And painful moments, they don't last forever. They come and go. But if I ruminate, if I resist, if I go against, if I fight it, what happens? It gets bigger. And it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And then I feel I need to advocate. From aggravation to advocation. which, of course, being passionate, there's nothing wrong. But where can I be most effective? To use my energy where I'm effective to make a change in the world. To make a difference in my relationships. To also inspire growth spiritually, mentally, physically, emotionally. It's as if I'm forgiving in every moment and allowing in every moment, accepting every moment. So you're actually honoring this present moment. And of course, now where the reasoning or intellect, as you can see between this, what's called sanskaras, but it's just these memory bank or the subconscious. And to understand what is down there, you know, I don't need to go scuba diving into the bottom of that lake. It's whatever surfaces to make to not only make peace with whatever surfaces, but also treasures, skill sets that we forgot we even knew or didn't even know we had. Have you been in those moments where, you know, you were able to speak in front of a crowd and you didn't even know you had that skill because you were passionate about something or you really felt purposeful? So our sense of purpose is there in the subconscious. Our values, our ethics. There's a lot of beauty and wealth of experience there. So I hope this helps you in the sense of these are tools. This is how we navigate, okay? Because sometimes it's difficult to move on and we feel stuck because we don't realize that we have tools right in front of us. We have skills within us. And we will attract to us the people that will help us, the situations. If I'm present and ready to catch the ball, whatever that opportunity is that will come with me in that present moment. Okay, so if I could close the PowerPoint for a moment and just come to screen, yeah. So what we're looking at here, I'm just using time and also the faculties of consciousness and how we perceive time and create a new relationship to time so that we can let go of the past and move on from the past so that we can embrace and make a difference in this moment. And as a conscient being, when I'm awake and aware, I can actually engage in choice. I always have a choice. When I get real quiet and still inside, and I just do these steps of accepting, observing, and then steering. We call it SOS, stop, and you're accepting, observe, and steer. Just three simple steps to help you be present and be available to make a choice. And how consciousness intersects with time. Here we are, this metaphysical being in a three-dimensional physical reality that is governed by time and space. And how can we, you know, cooperate together instead of fighting with time, buying time, competing with time, you know, it's an interesting thing, but to have a relationship with time by understanding it. And how valuable this present moment is. So that's those. I just wanted to how those two come together as a spiritual presence in this physical dimension, this physical reality. So what's real, is what's constant, and that's the soul. And the soul is love, bliss, innocence, truth, joy, etc., etc. It's real. It's constant. I always was and I always will be. Love always was and always will be. Peace, joy, truth. And what's relative is this physical dimension and what we bring to it and how we see it. And so this world of past memories will be projected onto it. And we'll try, well, it's not that it's plotting against me. I just let it. I will go on automatic because I haven't, you know, really exercised that muscle of the intellect. And that's what helps me to be aware and stay aware. Okay, so I hope that makes sense and we have that together. So next slide, please. And I've talked about this, and I think that I'll just say one thing about this with love. It really is about accepting and allowing. It doesn't mean I don't have boundaries and that I'm not aware of what my needs are, but And that I always have choice, but how I exercise that choice doesn't have to be with a sword and a shield. It can just be said in one word, yes or no, without a whole bunch of explanation. I can, or I'm not able. You know what I mean? Those moments where we feel we have to explain ourselves. But when we really know ourselves and understand what we need and really love ourselves, then we have something to offer. And so whenever I need to explain what I need or what is important to me in a relationship, and even defining my boundaries, that I'm able to express that and communicate it with respect. So for me, that's part of the healing of love, that there's a flow, that I'm not resenting, I'm not cutting off, I'm not blocking the flow. Okay, next slide. Now these are some of the tools. And I already talked about mindfulness, being the detached observer. And to gain insights takes reflection. And this is where that metaphor of the lake really is helpful to come in here. To be able to use that lens of consciousness or of reason and the observer, where in one moment I can see to the bottom of the lake. And just by just adjusting my focus, I can see to the top of the lake. And again, I adjust my focus and I can see the world around me or even my own reflection. And whatever information that comes from the bottom of the lake, I'm able to discern what is relevant in this moment or relevant to this issue or this situation, to keep it essenceful. Because if I find whenever I'm trying to make a decision and it just keeps on opening other issues, and then I have to think of this person or that thing, and then if I decide this, you know, and it just keeps multiplying like a bunch of folders that are opened up on your desktop. But when I come up with a solution or a possible solution that closes all those folders, you know, zoop, and I feel peace of mind and I feel centered, then I know that's the right decision. I've gained insight. And sometimes it's, you need to spread it all out to kind of see what's all out there. And then usually, for example, let me give an example. When I've had difficult situations with my family, I have a huge family. And when we're not in agreement with something, and it may not be in my favor, right? And I'll be really upset. It's like, what? Well, who do they think I am? You know, I'll really have difficulty with the situation. And then I'll sit real quiet. What should I do? How should I proceed? And then I have this thought, and that is to accept and bow in this particular situation. It would not be something I would normally have done. Usually I'm a proactive, I will speak my mind. But this time it was be quiet and allow and let them have the say. Just let this person have the say. And it went against my usual MO. But I found so much peace. It was all, I could feel like tearing up a little bit because it was just so peaceful. And I just had faith. And sure enough, when I followed through and just let it happen, it was accurate. And it just developed trust. It developed, just wonderful relationships. In another situation, it may mean speak up. Say something. Each situation will need a different tool, a different quality or ability. So to have that insight is to know, what filter or how I can discern a situation. Now, here we go. The next one is letting go of victimhood. I can't speak enough on this one. And I know you all know what I'm talking about with, victimhood, and even, I will talk about it. I bring it up in classes and about this victim mentality and, the powerful statement, behind that would be that no one can make you do anything unless you let them. And many illuminaries and self-help books, and they all talk about getting beyond victimhood. And recently something had happened where I and it always comes across where you feel like you're being attacked, but you're not really. It's just a challenge. And when you let go, you forgive, and the next step is to empower the self. I guess what I did in this situation was I understood where they were coming from, and I learned, and not only did I forgive, but I also lent a hand. And helped. I helped them to move forward. And by doing that, it freed me. I was able to move on. And I know that everyone is doing their best in playing their part. And they will have things, in their own psyche that will come up from their own subconscious, right? And they will feel threatened or not, and need validation. Victims are always wanting to need validation. And victims will attract other victims. And perpetrators are also good at being victims. I don't know how it works. But I guess if we thought about it, if we buy into this, that the world has done it to me, and I let go of that right to have choice, that right to be present, to be effective in that moment, then I'm going to feel that I have to, retaliate, advocate. Doesn't it create fear? It's from a place of fear. And fear is the opposite of love. Fear creates boundaries. Love has no boundaries. So I just look at these situations that are difficult sometimes in relationships, or even in how I see where I'm going with my career or my, what I have or what I need. That I understand that everything is happening for me, that there's some gem in this moment. And a lot of times when it's difficult, that's where the really good, because it stirs up a lot of stuff. And you will discover things that you've totally forgotten. Precious gems come to the surface. For example, if you look back at any challenge that you had, maybe last year or yesterday even, or if you look back at maybe a situation that's happened in your life that was difficult, and you got through it, and a matter of fact, when you think about it, you wouldn't be where you are today if that situation didn't happen, right? So in a lot of ways, we already have that ability to play the hero and not the victim. And I talked about learning. And this is also in nonviolent communication too, to be curious, that you're not going there to, validate yourself, meaning going into the arena. When I say going into it, where you feel vulnerable, exposed, because you need to have a say, or you're in that conference with your boss, where you're in that delicate moment with your spouse, when you're making decisions for your children, these delicate moments. And I go in it with that curiosity, with a learning, wanting to understand the other. And it will save a lot of time. And then, of course, how we identify ourselves. This is a big thing. It's interesting when I really see myself in an unlimited way, I'm much more effective. When you think of the heroes in your life, people who have motivated you, people who've inspired you, and these could be your aunt, your uncle, your parents, your sibling, the neighbor down the street, or a famous person. And what makes a hero? Think about it. Why is someone a hero? What makes a hero is that they are not hindered by limitations. I'm not old enough. I'm not young enough. I'm not beautiful enough. I'm not smart enough. I'm not wealthy enough. When you see that man with polio and he's still able to work, or you see that mother with two children and she gets, and she's a single parent and she puts herself through college by sewing, and gets herself a degree. I'm talking about my sister. She's just awesome. She's my hero. And she not only raised two girls, put them through school, she was a, got her teaching degree, and she also got her LCSW and is now a family counselor. So she's like a hero. She didn't say, oh, poor me, I'm going to just, you know, live off the government or whatever, you know, not to judge people that are surviving in that way. But she didn't limit herself. And so her identity wasn't, you know, stuck on this low self-esteem image of the self. And this whole thing about forgiveness, sometimes it's about forgiving the self, not just forgiving others. And this is, could we maybe close the slide, please? And then I'll just talk about forgiveness and gratitude. You know, I know you all must know the difference when you're able to let go of something and forgive and forget. But do you ever have that experience where you know you should forgive, but it's difficult, like you can't? And you're going, why can't I forgive? What is it? You know, I know I've got to let it go. And you think, oh yeah, I've forgiven this person. And then when you see them or something reminds you of them, you get all tense and your stomach gets tight, right? and your heart gets tight. So what has helped me on a deeper level to really let go, in each situation will be different, but in some situations where I go, wow, I really haven't let this go. I'm really having an issue in forgiving this person because deep inside I feel they've wronged me. And then I say, well, I take a moment and think about it. Well, they must have felt wronged, you know, and that's the learning on their end. But of what I realized, that the very thing that I had an issue in forgiving them, I have done to others. Like they'll say, we did once, we had a workshop here. It was like a day retreat on bullying. I would have never thought, you know, and I learned so much. I was not the facilitator, but I was the host and I participated. And she had this line, she drew this line down the middle of the room. And she said, okay, people who have ever been bullied go to the other side of the room. And so those who have been bullied go to the other side of the room. And the, you know, the spectators were on where the teacher was standing. And then she said, okay, those who have been bullied and then have also bullied others remain standing. And those that have not bullied others come back to our side of the line. Nobody crossed the line. And we all went, whoa. And you know, I'm kind of putting a little dramatic emphasis on this, and it's not a put down to the self really, but it just to own what belongs to the self. And you'll know how much, you know where I'm going with this. It's that, okay, where have I done this same thing to somebody else? And I don't need to find that moment in time or dig up that memory, but just kind of let it just sort of hover. Oh, yeah. And then what I do is I go, well, what made me think that way? And perhaps it was fear. Perhaps it is not feeling heard, a need for validation. And then you begin to see that person, the one that offended, in a whole different light. And in that moment, I was able to let go. And not only let go, but to come to the aid and be, even when you're able to let it go, actually, it helps the other person shift and let go. Because when I have good wishes for others, when I have good intention, good feelings towards those who have maybe offended me, I, you know, basically, I've freed myself. I have liberated myself. Now it's the other person's choice if they want to liberate themselves. Can I really forgive the debt of somebody else? I mean, if someone has done wrong to me, maybe they owe me $100. And they don't intend on paying it back. And I relinquish, I say, I forgive you. You don't have to pay me back. But karmically, have I relinquished that? I can't relinquish someone else's debt. Karmically, they owe the universe $100. Do you see what I'm saying? Because deep inside, that person knows they owe someone. And they could cover it up like, I don't owe anybody anything, you know. But deep in the psyche, there's a sense of unworthiness that's there because they weren't able to pay that $100. Now, I'm just using an example. Any metaphor won't be perfect, but it's just to illustrate that how we can attract these situations to us. And what it means to flow and let go. When I hold on, what do you experience? What would I experience? When I'm holding on, when I'm holding back, when I'm holding my breath, if the heart holds on, it's a heart attack. If the lungs aren't breathing, it's an anxiety attack. If the stomach, you know, is holding on, it's constipation, and it can be painful, and it can be deadly. Same with the nervous system. I'll never forget going to an acupuncturist. I had really messed up a disc in my back. I mean, I could, you know, walking was an effort, a real effort. And I had a few sessions with a really good acupuncturist, and it was a whole new world for me. I've never had anybody stick needles in me. But after that session, and this was a traditional, really skilled, I just was lucky, very lucky in San Francisco. And after that session, my head was like, I mean, so much energy was flowing and I was relieved of pain, but it was like, oh my gosh, I didn't realize how vital our nervous system is. Because we sort of, you know, we just take it for granted, you know. But I had to sit in the car for 15 minutes so that, you know, that energy, you know, was like, oh, like this. And I went, wow, and I just, this image of stuck energy and to get it unstuck, that feeling of flow. And so these are just some offerings of what and how we can let go. If we could go back to the slides. Thank you. I have Jayesh helping me. Okay. Now, this is something I would really like to share with you that has really helped me immensely. And it's like we can understand these concepts, and maybe some of these are new, and some of them you know, and some of them you've even practiced, and probably some needs more practice. But where I feel and have experienced the most benefit is to have a divine reference. What it does, and I'm talking about God, I'm talking about whatever that is for you, whatever your spiritual beliefs, religious beliefs, but to have something that you can count on that's good, that's pure, that's loving, universal, and empowering. And, you know, this illustration here is just to kind of help you understand that there is something that we can tap into, just like a radio station. And so you see the different radios, you know, in the old days, transistor radios, or they, you know, the system of getting music was through, you know, a radio station. And if you could forward a little bit, please, on the slide. Jayesh? Oh, okay. It doesn't reveal it. Okay. So underneath, it just shows that, like, I'll just describe this metaphor. It did a cute little thing, but it's a frozen slide, so I'm not able to have the animation for you. But to imagine that divine reference available to anyone, and that you and I are like transistor radios. And all we have to do is tune in to KGOD. Okay? And it's this really refined frequency, very subtle, very elevated. And so it's a different value system. It's not light, dark, bad, good. It's just a high, pure vibration. And each of us has a memory of this. And sometimes we stumble onto it where we just feel like everything is in harmony. And, you know, I call it the ping feeling. It's not this, it's not that. It's like do, 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 ping, 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 where you just, like when that candle light is perfectly still and the carbon just goes straight off the top, it's like this aha kind of moment that lingers, where you really feel your eternal presence and a connection with a supreme source of energy that cannot wait to love the soul, that cannot wait to empower the soul. But I just have to tune in. And how do we do that? How do I connect? Well, it helps to understand that, you know, it is a tuning in, and that the radio waves are everywhere, right? The room is filled now with so many waves, communication waves. But depending on the instrument, I can tune in to whether it's Bluetooth or Wi-Fi, or transistor radio, or a regular FM AM radio. But depending on the instrument, I can tune in. And I navigate. It's like a God positioning system, a GPS of the soul. When I'm in resonance, and I have to first start with the self, that I realize that I am conscious energy, that I'm a visitor here. I came into this world, and one day I will leave this world. Nothing here in the physical world belongs to the soul. But I'm here to create. I'm here to explore and experience. And I can leave behind limited creations or inspire or a legacy, but I don't take it with me. And that there is a place, a still place that I call home, where I experience that presence of the divine, and where I feel an affinity that I feel one with. So next slide. So there's different metaphors. I talked about empowerment and that it's an eternal source of energy that I can be in alignment with. And just like a battery needs a generator, or a battery can recharge itself. You know, when we go through life, you know, if you know how a battery works, it's molecules, right? They're long molecules, and they have a positive charge and a negative charge. And when the battery's fresh, all the negative charge is facing one direction and the positive is in another direction. And so then there's this flow of energy coming into that battery unit. And after use, the molecules inside begin to waver and get out of alignment. And so then when it's totally drained, then all the molecules are out of alignment. And so when you recharge a battery, it just brings it back in alignment. So imagine the soul is like this little battery, and we come fresh into the world. And you know how attractive children are? It's like magic comes to them, and they, you know, they rule the world. The whole world revolves around them. And then as they grow and mature and get more identified with the physical world and relationships, and who am I going to be when I grow up, and get banged around a bit, then we lose power. And sometimes we meet up with brick walls. And so these humbling moments will ask us to go within, you know. And then we find that solace, we find that quiet and peace. And this is where peace is a power, because it helps me to navigate to that eternal source of power, and not a power over. It doesn't work that way. It's a power that stabilizes. Limited power in the world destabilizes. It's limited. Sooner or later, it will run out, fall apart, drain. Everything that's created goes through these cycles of growth, birth, growth, maturity, and decay. Civilizations, any creation, natural or man-made, everything goes through this lovely cycle. And then from the falling apart, the going to the seed, right? And then regeneration and growth. And we do it again. And that's just the cycles, the natural cycles of life that surround us. And here we, as a spiritual presence, how can we have a healthy relationship with these cycles? I'm eternal spiritual presence, a loving, peaceful presence. And I'm coexisting in this reality that is born, that grows, that matures, and falls apart. So chances are I should invest in that energy that stabilizes. So that I remain on par with that high frequency and empower the soul, the self, myself, awareness, right? Consciousness. So that I can constantly be moving on and in the flow and present. When I'm in the flow, I am present. Sounds funny, huh? Because each moment keeps passing. Even this moment, it becomes the next. I'm witnessing flow by being present as a spiritual energy. I am witnessing the cycles of life. But when I get identified with the physical, I lose that navigation power, that power of choice. I get stuck. And that's where the constrictions happen, the blockages happen, because I want it to be what it was, what, you know, I want it to stay how it is, but nothing stays. Children grow up, I have an empty nest, I have to retire. I mean, you know, everything goes through phases. So how to embrace each phase and enjoy each phase, not only of my personal life, but of the creations around me. And this is also part of the healing and having that connection with the divine. It just keeps me in the flow. And like I mentioned before, on a physical level, when things are flowing, it heals. A doctor, the first thing they want to do is start circulation. Whether it's neuro, cardio, respiratory, we have to start the flow. And so that goes with our thoughts, emotional flow. So the mental flow, emotional flow, and spiritual. That I just remain awake and present. Even as I'm giving this talk, and that I trust, and that I trust that whatever I'm saying, if I'm really present, that I'm honoring knowledge in such a way that I will say something new and wonderful that I never thought of before. If I'm really present. Because knowledge, even, I can't own it. I can't. It's not mine. That's why Brahma Kumaris, we never charge for, you know, what we teach. We just want it to do service, to continue to grow. And that when people understand themselves and have a safe place to explore and learn about themselves, then it's just going to keep manifesting. We're investing in what's possible. And of course, when I have that meditation with the divine, that's where this absorption of qualities, where I experience the beauty of the Supreme Being, being in that presence. And it's something that's familiar, and it's very humbling and empowering at the same time, very respectful. So I don't know if you have any questions. We're coming to the end of our time together, but I'd love to hear from you. If we could maybe close the slides. And I hope that I offered some content that perhaps you may have known before, but allowed you to go a little deeper, and also just to learn some skills that, or some methods that you could practice to develop your skills and to sustain that flow in your life, so that you can easily let go, that it doesn't have to wait hours or days or years, but that you can begin to see that mechanism as it unfolds. And save a lot of time, actually, to recognize and make choices that benefit in that moment. So any thoughts, Leia?
Yes, I mean, I've been working on this pretty strong for the last couple of years, and all these things that you're mentioning, connecting to the divine and trusting and forgiveness and gratitude. I've tried all of those things, and I'm here to say it does work. It does absolutely work. And just practicing and looking inside and seeing how, you know, if you upset somebody or if you're feeling upset, just really understanding how we're all interconnected and how it's not one thing that's causing a problem. It's usually many. Might come from the past, might come from thoughts, might come from various things, but usually it just sits and it's from yourself. And just seeing how we're connected. So if anybody's ever upset with you and you're like, what is this? This is not me, this is you, you know, but like, if you can just kind of detach and, you know, not be heated in the moment, but just to save that energy to look inside rather than spew out, you know, words that could be hurtful or you might not be able to recover a relationship from, is very important, just to harness that energy. You know, if somebody gets you fired up or pushes your buttons, to just take a moment and breathe and harness the energy, but don't give it out right away. Give it to yourself first. Mm-hmm. And then it'll kind of wash over you, and then the answers will come. But all of these things that you're mentioning tonight are just so true, and I've practiced all of them, and it does work for sure. Rama Kumar has really opened up a lot of channels for me that I've always known have been in me, but haven't really been accepting. I haven't always been accepting of you know, the practice of having energy, having good energy to share. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Leia. Thank you so much for sharing.
You're welcome.
Nagita?
Well, I would say almost the ditto feelings, what Leia said. And for me, what usually I do is, sometimes I think that happens sometimes because of misunderstanding. Sometimes I think that we are sitting side by side looking at something and thinking that we are looking at the same picture, but we are looking at two different pictures. And then we don't understand each other sometimes. So what works for me is forgiving our others is easier than forgiving yourself. Sometimes, like I would get mad at myself, or not anymore, but I used to blame myself for everything. Why did I get involved? Why did I even open my mouth? Why I have to tell them? Why I have to help others? So, you know, and I would blame myself. And then I had to really think that, well, I do whatever I have to do. And sometimes it is not what other people want, or they misunderstand. And I don't think I all played victim as such for others, but for myself. Like I was fighting against my own sanskars. So what I learned is when we have to say, especially for the relationships. Luckily for me, most of my relationships are wonderful. So I always, I'm grateful for those. And then I say, whatever is not working in some areas, I say, okay, we have to have something which we do not understand each other. Mm-hmm. Or I have to forgive myself. I have to forgive that person. I forgive myself for taking the pain. Mm-hmm. Forgive the other for whatever I have mm-hmm. given them pain, knowingly, unknowingly. Mm-hmm. And then I make sure that in present, something doesn't trigger me to remember the past experiences and react the same way again.
Yeah.
So I have to be a little bit aware of that. Something always triggers the past memories.
Oh, yeah.
Which I don't, you don't even know you remember. And so that I started taking control of myself, because when something triggers, it just goes so, and it's very difficult to understand or control. So, yes.
Thank you, Geeta. I think you hit it on, you know, on the head there. You said a little aware, but it's probably a lot of aware, being aware.
That comes with this.
Yeah. Kelly, I don't know if you, Kelly, I didn't know if you wanted to share anything.
I don't have anything as insightful as what Leah and Geeta shared. Just, you know, maybe I can talk about some of the things that resonated with me that, you know, I took some notes. And one thing you said, and I think it was almost just kind of like a side comment, but you said something about exercise the muscle of the intellect to be aware and stay present. And I hadn't thought of it like that before. And it was sort of, it was like, oh yeah, I need to practice and make that muscle stronger. And I, you know, I've been doing all these workshops and doing the Friday meditations and other things, but I, you know, I haven't been meditating on my own.
Mm.
It's like, I'm not doing the homework.
Okay.
And so I think that would make a big difference if I started to do that. You know, yeah. I'm definitely my own worst enemy, and like, you know, the person I need to forgive the most is myself. Like Geeta was saying, that's definitely the hardest.
That actually is very profound. It's simple. And even for those of us that have been practicing meditation for a while, we can get lazy and even a little overconfident, you know, and then you'll find yourself sitting and making the time, but you're wandering, you know, you're not being focused, and it just becomes a discipline. I mean, there's just different phases that happen, and how to keep it fresh and exciting. But yeah, it is a muscle. It's, and we have to do reps. But it doesn't have to be strenuous. And it's really the first one is, who am I? Mm-hmm. And you know, just to keep going, wait a minute, I'm the driver. I'm the driver here. I've got my foot on the gas. I have my hands on the steering wheel. That it takes a lot of muscle. It's like calisthenics. I call it calisthenics of the soul. I am peace. Okay, hold it. Don't let go. And after a while you go, oh. It's, you go, wow. Because the old pattern wants to take over, and that's the automatic pilot.
So, another thing I find, sister, that when we say practice, it's not easy to practice because that doesn't happen every single day, right? Mm-hmm. We can't practice it that way, that with every single person, every single moment, everything we do. And day-to-day life usually is kind of peaceful, and that happens only once in a while and with some particular people. It doesn't happen with everybody. So practicing is kind of hard. So meditation definitely helps, because then you become like that, and your sanskars are changed slightly, and you are more aware of at that moment.
Right.
Otherwise, we just react.
And see, but then that's the skills. Meditation.
Yes.
But go ahead, Gita.
Yeah, so that's what I was saying. Like, practicing just with people is not possible, because it doesn't happen, luckily, every single day or very often.
Yeah, that is the challenge.
So
yes, it is the challenge.
So we have to,
but it is the aim. It is the aim, Gita. And it'll come more and more. And instead of doing what you always did, you'll start to see that you're actually navigating through the situation. You're actually even making different choices, and not being triggered or witnessing the button. Someone's trying to push your button, but it doesn't, you know.
Yes.
It doesn't engage, and you actually go into another mode, maybe learning, or maybe loving, or maybe understanding, or forgiving at every moment is what I call it. As it's happening, you are in a moment of, you are just forgiving. And I think that's the aim of Raja Yoga meditation, is that I am a sovereign in every moment. I am not a victim.
Yeah.
In that moment.
So meditation helps to do that.
Yeah, so that's why we call it karma yoga.
Yes.
So while in action, I'm connected.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful. Okay, well, let's have a meditation and close for the evening. Thank you so much for coming. And we have our next Tuesday talk. And we have our Friday meditation in the evening. And you can find out more on our website, anubhutiretreatcenter.org or bksanfrancisco.org. All right. So let's just honor this time we've had together and just sit back. And let's take this opportunity, taking a deep breath in, just letting go, relaxing, even let go of all the ideas and concepts. And be the witness of your own feelings and thoughts right now in this moment. I am simply aware. I am a conscient, loving soul. And the original qualities of the soul are eternal and stable. The soul is love. The soul is constantly in the flow. Loving, peaceful presence. The soul, when it's aware, is in a state of its own power of choice. Stable, constant. Full, benevolent, and in this awareness, I easily tap into that pure frequency of the divine. Like a switch, I can turn on and plug into that generator of love, the ocean of peace. And reciprocate that love and peace with the divine. I am in love with the ocean of love. The soul is empowered, rejuvenated, and the soul easily becomes aware of the physical body, as a witness and an observer of this beautiful world of form, time, and space. And I return as a radiant, peaceful being. Om Shanti.